Welcome to Enter the Unknown. My name is FJ, and after completing random card challenges in Kanto and Johto, we're headed for Hoenn to test out Pokemon Emerald. We're here today to try to see if you can beat the final Gen 3 game by drawing random cards for every major battle. Basically, if we're facing an opponent with 4 Pokemon, we draw 4 random cards, match levels, and take them on in a set battle with no items allowed, held, or otherwise. For the last random card challenge, I randomized the entire game, but that was pretty divisive, so this time around we're just playing vanilla Pokemon Emerald. I've split the cards into 3 groups for this one. We've got all of the cards representing Pokemon with base stat totals of 350 or lower to start things off. The early battles obviously won't have particularly strong opponents, so holding back seems wise. After taking down Brawly, we'll add the second pile, which contains all of the Pokemon whose base stat totals fall between 351 and 450. Then finally, after collecting 4 gym badges, we'll add the last stack, which is made up of all the Pokemon who have a base stat total north of 450. That will hopefully keep the challenge pretty even and stop the beginning of the game from being a total breeze. Alright, that's the concept of the series, so let's draw our first card, which will be to determine May's starter. I don't have cards for Treecko, Torchic, or Mudkip, so we're going to be using energies instead. And it looks like May will be going through the game with the grass starter. It's tough to know if that's good or bad right now because who knows what teams will be using against her. What you're watching here are the first batch of cards going into the draw. These are all of the Pokemon whose base stat totals sit at or below 350. I'm just going through them quickly so you can get an idea of what cards are on the table for these early battles. Alright, now it's time to find out what Pokemon we'll be using for our first face off with May. Okay, we're going to be attempting to take her down with just a Caterpie. That's probably gonna be pretty tough. What a fitting card to start with after my 2 Pokemon Sword bug videos. So, as you can see, we've replaced Mudkip with Caterpie to ensure May gets the correct starter, but that's the only change to this game file. Well, I've also given myself a ton of Master Balls and will have to edit the wild encounters to get the Pokemon that I need, but other than that, it's plain old Pokemon Emerald. We nicknamed our Caterpie Petrie Jr., and she's just got Tackle and String Shot. I have a feeling this is going to take a whole lot of luck. Alright, let's see how long this one takes. May of course sends out her Treecko, and we choose Petrie Jr. Our quote-unquote rival calls for Leer to start things off, but it doesn't really make a difference. Treecko's damage-dealing move is Pound, which has 100% accuracy, so either May instructs the grass starter to attack 5 times, or she calls for Leer and 4 pounds. Both combinations are good for 5-turn KOs. If Caterpie can connect with 5 consecutive tackles, then that's also enough to score a knockout, but as she's much slower than Treecko, that's never gonna happen. This time around, a critical hit on the 4th tackle handed us the win, and that was exactly what we needed. How many attempts did it take for us to hit 4 times in a row with a crit without May getting the same luck? 27. It took 27 tries. I really hope that's not a sign of things to come. After witnessing our dad do more for a stranger than he's ever done for us, we head out of Petalburg and towards Rustboro City for our first gym battle. Roxanne's an interesting one. 3 defensive Pokemon with typings resistant to normal could easily cause us massive problems. Keep in mind, at this low level, some Pokemon won't have even learned any decent stab moves. Anyway, we're going to be using Magikarp, not great, Execute, and Ekans. Now, as I didn't mention this earlier, I'll put it out there now. I'm always going to match levels in the order the cards were drawn. I'll always be using Bulbapedia for our opponent's team order too. More often than not, they're listed from lowest to highest, but there'll be a few that aren't. For this one, that means we'll have Magikarp and Execute at level 12, and Ekans at level 15. I bring that up because at level 13, Execute learns its first grass-type move in the shape of Leech Seed. Alright, let's have a look at the team. First up, we've got Tico the Magikarp at level 12, and he's got the move Splash. Yeah, if we'd pulled Magikarp last, we could have had Tackle, but that probably wouldn't have made much of a difference. Up second, we've got Hexova the Execute, also at level 12, and his moveset's made up of Uproar, Hypnosis, Reflect, and Bullet Seed. Thankfully, you can get the TM for Bullet Seed prior to the first gym, otherwise I think we'd have next to no chance here. Finally, we've got Eltar the Ekans, who's our soul level 15, and he's equipped with Bite, Leer, Rap, and Poison Sting. Although it seems counterintuitive, his best strategy is going to be chomping down on some rocks. Prior to the physical special split, that wasn't the worst idea. Alright, thanks to Bullet Seed, I'm feeling reasonably confident. Let's jump into it. The Rustboro gym leader leads off with her first Geodude, and we send out Magikarp first. I'm not entirely sure why, maybe it's an intimidation tactic. We then execute a slightly superior intimidation tactic by switching out to Ekans, whose ability actually is Intimidate. As I mentioned, our strategy here is to bite Roxanne's rock types until they can't take it anymore. A couple of attacks force the gym leader to use her first potion, and although Eltar sustains some serious damage, the poison snake finishes off Geodude with another two bites. As Ekans has had his speed lowered and I'd like another intimidate drop, we switch back out to Tico after Roxanne sends in her second Geodude. One defense curl later and we're right back out to Ekans, who gets off one final dark type attack before falling to Rocktoon. Although Magikarp can be an absolute powerhouse on his day, with 40 PP of splash left, we're essentially in a 1-on-2 now. Hexova comes in and before even firing off a second blast, Bulletseed knocks out Geodude number 2 to leave Roxanne with just her ace. Nosepass comes in and after being pelted by a succession of seeds, she wastes a turn by using Harden. As we're in Gen 3, Bulletseed is a special move and raising her defense really changes nothing. Hexova pays for missing Hypnosis when Rocktoon cuts away almost a third of his health, but after being blocked into battle, he puts Nosepass to sleep at the second time of asking. Another Bulletseed comes up just short, which forces Nosepass to sleep eat her Oranberry before waking up to hit with Tackle. Execute has another chance to earn us the win, but only lands two strings of Bulletseed. That allows Roxanne to break out her second potion, and at this point I'm a little bit nervous. Another Bulletseed low roll takes the rock type below half health yet again, before we get lucky with Roxanne calling for Tackle instead of Rocktoon. Finally, a critical hit on another Jewel Blast of Bulletseed hands us the win in a battle that ended up being closer than was necessary. I think it's safe to say that if the early game TM to help with Roxanne was something like Bubble instead of Bulletseed, our run would have been coming to an end right here. At the very least, we would have needed a lot of luck with Hypnosis. Alright, having picked up badge number 1, we can deal with all of the Mr. Briny stuff before heading south to take on Mei. This is an optional battle, but there aren't too many mandatory face-offs with your rival in Gen 3, so I thought I may as well do this one. There are literally only 3 required Mei battles in Emerald, and you've already seen one of them. For this one, we're going to be using Electrike and Metapod, which is okay. Not the best, but it should work. We've got Tesla the Electrike at level 13, but unfortunately she doesn't learn any Electric-type attacks until Spark at level 20. Instead, her moveset's made up of Tackle, Thunderwave, Leer, and Howl. On what is a very rare occurrence in random card challenges, Petrie Jr. actually gets to return for a second battle. Since you saw her last, she's evolved and learned the move Harden. Okay, let's give this a go. Mei leads off with her Wingull and we send out Electrike first. This is where an Electric-type attack really would have come in handy. I love how unbalanced this battle is depending on who you chose as your starter. I assume it's just an error, but if you selected Torchic, then Mei starts this battle with a Torkoal. That's 200 base points higher than Wingull and 250 higher than Lotad, who are other options here. Later, Torkoal's replaced by Slugma, so I'm fairly certain that's who she was supposed to have here, but it's just a ridiculously strong Pokemon to come across this early on. We don't have any such problem though. After paralyzing Wingull with Thunder Wave, we can switch out to Metapod to take her out with a series of tackles. Mei then sends out Treecko, who comes face to face with Petrie Jr. for the 28th time, but 26 of those have been wiped from his memory, so he only remembers the loss. We switch Tesla back in and go for Thunder Wave once again. We then call for a couple of Leers to lower Treecko's defense before finally attacking with Tackle. A critical hit gives the Grass Starter some vivid flashbacks, but his Quick Attack leaves Electrike with only a single hit point remaining. Her second Tackle takes him into red health too before we switch out to spare Tesla. Metapod slams into the stationary Woodgecko, finishing him off to take Petrie Jr.'s win-loss record against him up to 2-26. Okay, now we're getting somewhere. Two rival battles and a gym battle all cleaned up already. We may as well go for one more gym badge while we're here though. Brawly's another interesting one. If we can draw any half-decent flying type, then we should be okay, but there are plenty of normal types in the mix here. We need a team of 3 for this gym too, and it looks like we're gonna have Jigglypuff, Sandshrew, and Zubat. That's not ideal. Although we do have a partial flying type, it comes to us too early to learn any flying type moves. Before taking on Brawly, I decided to visit Granite Cave to deliver a letter to Steven Stone. The former Hoenn champion rewards us with a TM for Steel Wing, which could be a big help to Zubat, whose other attacks aren't ideal for a fighting type gym. Speaking of, let's check out the team. Up first, we've got Taffy the Jigglypuff at level 16 with the moves Pound, Flash, Sing, and Disable. Not entirely sure what the strategy is for him, but it's probably going to involve relying on an inaccurate status move. Up next, we've got Dijon the Sandshrew, who's also at level 16, and she's got Cut, Defense Curl, Sand Attack, and Rock Tomb. Honestly, I'm not really sure what the strategy is at all here, but I'll figure it out when we get into battle. Last up, we've got Taboo the Zubat, who's at level 19, and her moveset's made up of Steel Wing, Supersonic, Leech Life, and Bite. We're really relying on the TMs that the game's providing right now, but I guess that's why they're there. Alright, this one could go either way, let's get into it. Brawly leads off with his Machop, and we start things out with Jigglypuff. After the fighting type uses Bulk Up, Taffy connects with Sing to put him to sleep. Then, after lowering his accuracy with Flash, Jigglypuff somehow fails to connect a second time even though he's asleep. The Flash does succeed in waking Machop up, who strikes with Karate Chop, leaving Taffy in red health. Machop then swings at Fresh Air, allowing Jigglypuff to hit with Pound, but that will be his last action. Another Karate Chop knocks the wind out of the balloon Pokemon, finishing him off and taking us down to two. We call on Zubat next, hoping against hope that a single Steel Wing will do the job. It's really not even close, and after Machop attacks with Seismic Toss, Brawl uses a Super Potion which sends us right back to square one. It does at least mean that while Machop's recovering, Taboo can strike twice. The first Steel Wing doesn't do too much, but on the way back she catches him unawares, landing a critical hit that almost leads to a knockout. Machop then wastes what should be his last turn on Bulk Up, but Zubat lets him off the hook by missing Steel Wing. Luckily, his Karate Chop doesn't do too much, and finally, after about 30 turns, Broly's first team member is down. Meditite is up next for the Jufra Gym Leader, and as I'm sure most of you know, he poses absolutely no threat. Focus Punch is his only damage-dealing move, so as long as we don't stop attacking, there's no way we can get hit. Even better than that, thanks to Zubat's Leech Life, we can recover all of the HP we lost before moving on to Broly's Ace. This took way too long because for some reason Broly wasted a Super Potion on this blatant lost cause, which really slowed things down. Eventually, after 13 uses of Leech Life, a fourth bite crits the free pass and leaves us in a 2-on-1. I'd like to make the case that Broly's Makuhita is the scariest, terrible gym Pokemon ever. If you think about the aces of the other early game second gym leaders, Makuhita's kind of a joke. Misty's Starmie has a base stat total of 520, Bugsy's Scyther's at 500, and Gardenia's Roserade's at 515. Makuhita sits at a comparatively pathetic 237. That's lower than Zigzagoon or Whismur. If you're not prepared for Makuhita though, it can be absolutely devastating. We started this one incredibly carelessly though. I wanted to confuse Makuhita and then switch out to Sandshrew to get some accuracy drops, and although we do eventually make that happen, Dijon is taken out way too easily. By the time Zubat is sent back in, we've barely damaged Broly's ace, but he's managed to use Bulk Up twice. We go through a few turns whittling down his health with Steel Wing, but he's hitting much harder. When he munches down a Citrus Berry to recover almost all of his lost health, it seems like we're fighting a losing battle. From there though, all of our setup starts to pay off. Makuhita hits himself in confusion a few times before missing another shot, but after Steel Wing takes the fighting type into red health, Reversal connects to leave Taboo with only 8 HP. Luckily, she doesn't miss with the final Steel Wing this time around, and with almost no health remaining, Zubat hands us another win. Broly gives us badge number 2, and I think that's gonna do it for part 1. I've got a good feeling about this series. In episode 2, we're going to be adding the second deck into the mix and going after Watson, but until then, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.